Yo, 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 we live on location. Me and D Miles, as always, we chilling here in Orlando, staying our ass at home, safe in quarantine. And we got a very, very special guest, not a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, but a 7-time world champion, y'all.
Legend.
And he was involved in every last one of them. So he a real world champ with these.
Real legend.
We got my man coming to you live on location from Los Angeles, California, y'all. We got Big Shot Robert Horry in the building. Appreciate you, Chilla, pulling up on us, OG.
Man, my pleasure, man. I'm glad to be on the show, man. I had a request to be on the show, man, to get some stuff right, so I'm glad I'm on the show.
right away.
And we got it done. So you come right on here and set the record straight, man. It's all love.
Appreciate you, OG, man. It's definitely
my
love,
pleasure,
man.
Guys. Much success, y'all.
Brought to you by AT&T 5G.
First question we ask everybody who come on the show is, when you first made it to the league, who's the first person to bust your ass?
Dominique.
Ooh.
Oh, man. And that was in preseason. So you know I was in for a long year. But you got to realize, when I came in, you had Dominique, you had Bird, you had Scotty, you had the three spot. You know how
three spot was loaded.
Was the most dangerous spot. And you had, one day you might have a guy post you up. One day you might have a guy coming off picks like Chuck Person. You might have a guy like Scotty that's doing everything, got you all over the floor. So it was a dangerous position.
I think people kind of forget, especially the younger kids of this day, they look at Dominique as, oh, he was this crazy human highlight dunker. But boy, he was a bucket.
Yes.
A real problem. He was getting 40s, 50s, whatever.
Posting you up, jump you. You know, he had a three game, then he had the pull up game, then he had the post up game. You know, and don't piss him off because you're going to get dunked on. You know, it's just one of those things.
Yeah, you was so nasty, boy.
You was born in Maryland, but you grew up in Alabama.
Correct, yes.
How you pronounce that? I don't want to mispronounce it.
Andalusia.
Andalusia.
But if you're from Spain, it's called Andalusia because it's like it's a type of horse. And the only reason I know that is because of a TV show called Alias I used to watch with Jennifer Garner. They had an episode where she was in Andalusia, and they were talking about the horse. So.
Dang.
Kind of like I'm not that smart. I'm not that smart to research all that now.
So tell us about high school there, like when you came up high school, because you was the player of the year. Like, how was it when you first got to the high school your freshman year and had to build your rep?
Yeah, but coming from Maryland.
Yeah. You know, it was because my dad was in the military. That's the reason I was born. You know, he spent 30 years in the Army. That's why I was born in Maryland. My mom was a school teacher. And she's from Alabama. She went to Alabama A&M, and she just, you know, settled back in her hometown of Andalusia. So I went there. It was kind of easy transition for me because my brother is 4 years older than me. He kind of just took me under his wing and kind of guided me through it. And it was a learning process. I'm very, very grateful for the coaches I had growing up. You know, I remember my first coach in elementary school. One day we was playing basketball and I was killing everybody going right. He was like, you cannot go right anymore. I'm like, why? He says, because a basketball player should be able to go right and left. And I'm like, I don't want to play anymore. Because I couldn't go left, right? So I'm like, I'm not doing this. So, and then I had a middle school coach. He was great. And my high school coach was the best. You know, he was like, he was the one that said, this is, you know, after my brother left, he's like, my sophomore year, says, this is your team. How you go is how they're going to go. And he put the onus on me to be a leader at a young age and, you know, and take responsibility of the team, get them in shape, make sure they're in the gym. So I just had a really good transition. I think a lot of that had to do with growing up in a small town. And I don't know if this has to do anything, but my first three coaches were all black. You know, growing up in Alabama, they took you under their wing and treated you as their son. So that made a big difference. I think a big difference in my tutelage and my upbringing that I had black coaches until I got to college.
When did you know in high school that you was good enough nationally? Because, you know, when you take over the area or you take up, because I'm from a small town. When you take over the small town, it's like, yeah, that's cool. But, you know, it's Chicago and all these big cities. When did you know nationally that you was good enough to compete with them type of guys?
I, I think my junior year, I played in this tournament. And this tournament had Chris Jackson. It had, I can't remember his name. Dave Johnson. I went to Syracuse. We went in this tournament, and we played Dave Johnson's team. And, you know, Dave Johnson's on the bench. And the first team is, like, beating us by 15. And the coach subs a whole five. You know, you're not used to it. He subs a whole five like it's an AAU team.
Right.
And Dave Johnson team come. I'm like, holy crap. And they next thing you know, we're down 30 in 5 minutes, right? And that let me know then that there are people out there, you know, that are good, you know, that you gotta up your game. You gotta get back in the lab, you gotta work on everything. And it took some time for me to really hit home. You said, okay, that's just two guys. Chris Jackson won MVP of that tournament, by the way. He averaged 42 points a game.
That was a bad move was crazy. Man, yes. Boy. Woo.
Yes. And then, you know, I think my coming out part was going to BC camp and Nike camp and having all these camps where I got to see these guys that were ranked ahead of me. And I got a chance to, you know, learn what I need to work on. You know, I remember hanging out with Sean Kemp and, you know, Sean Kemp, Allen Houston. We were just hanging out, and Sean Kemp, Sean Kemp was a guy that got me to realize to kill the people who are ranked in front of you or try to kill them. So I say, I remember he was looking at Lonzo Mourning like, he's ranked higher than me. He's the number one player. How in the hell is he number one? And the next game, he went out and just roasted Lonzo. He was doing things that I'm like, God, why is this guy not the number one player in the country? And then, of course, you had Chris Jackson on the side, jaying everybody up too. But the things that Sean could do was amazing. And for me, I've always been the type of person to look at people around me and try to learn from them. It might not be a skill set. It might be just a mentality thing. You know, I look at all the guys that play with you in the league. You have to learn from everybody. When they say you have to be a sponge, that's a true meaning. You sponge. You soak up everything you can.
Yeah. So when you won player of the year your senior year, like, how did that make you feel? It was like validation. Like, it's my state right here. This is I run this.
You know, it's weird because you have a lot of doubters, you know, and you always have people like, oh, he's too skinny. You know, you got this one guy that's playing a tight end, Marcus Webb, that actually went to Alabama. He should be the number one player in the state. You know, you had another guy named Kenny played. He actually played us, but Kenny, he's like, he should be. You had all these doubters. I'm like, you know, everybody was doubting me and saying this about me because I was so skinny. I went to the state tournament and my team got beat by 40. So they were saying Robert Horrible. You know, they took the Ori and said Horrible. But for me, I said, you know what? I'm the number one player in the state. I can prove it. And I'm going out and I could average 40 points a game. But I was so intent on getting my guys involved.
You was a team player.
Yeah, I've always been a great team player, and that's one thing nobody can ever say, you know, bad about me, that I wasn't a team player, you know, except maybe, you know, that guy in Phoenix. But everybody loved me, and I know I was a great team player because when I left high school, my high school team lost in the high school championship game. The other team hit a shot from half court at the buzzer. So me, I got those guys ready. I helped them
make that run
to mature. And to make that run because I put them in a position mentally and physically to know what to do. You know, they might not be able to do it with me, but they learned from me and to go on and be a championship quality team.
One of the things I used to hate in high school, because I was a skinny cat in high school, they used to be like I wasn't physical. Like I wasn't physical, and I felt like I was the most physical person out there. I'm talking so physical to the point I used to throw cheap shots to just show that I was just – just mean and rugged.
There,
I was the skinniest thing out there.
You got to think about it. Growing up in Alabama, a lot of schools in my area, they were like, if you played basketball, you had to play football. So those guys were, you know, in back in 88, 92, we didn't lift weights. You know, it was like you lift weights. We had that mentality, if you lift weights, it's going to throw your shot up. You got to be skinny. You got to be fast. You got to be quick. You know, sort of like basketball is today. And you would get there, next thing you know, you have this big tight end that lay a pick on you, sliding across the floor. I remember one time I got hit in the ribs. One time, boy, I was like, oh man, I looked around, everybody was looking at me and see if I was gonna cry. You gotta get up.
Yeah. You know, I came back. They sent them in just to beat you up. Yeah. Just to beat you up. They sent them.
But you know what I did though? I came back down. I told the guy, just give me a pick. I'm just gonna try to dunk on him. I came in, I dunked on him, and like I looked at him, says, you don't scare me, you know. And that embarrassed him. So he was kind of like, okay, I'm not going to get this dude for real. You're going to get beat up, but you got to take that challenge and you got to go and show him that, hey, I'm going to keep coming. Because if I keep coming, that means you know you ain't got the best of me. I got the best of you.
Right. Yeah. Hey, so let me ask you this. With you being from Alabama and winning the player of the year and the state and everything like that, was it heavy, heavy pressure for you to go to the state school?
From my mama.
that's the most important.
Exactly.
Hey, look.
You know, I think with my mom, and I understood where she was coming from, Alabama started recruiting me as sophomore, so did Auburn. But my heart, I wanted to be a Ramblin' Wreck of Georgia Tech. I just wanted to play for Bobby Crimmins so bad. And I think if they would have recruited me early on, that I would have probably went to Georgia Tech, because my whole mindset is, when you think of Alabama, you don't think basketball, you think straight football. Right. And my high school team was a football school. Even though we didn't win a lot, we didn't win any championships, we always got beat. They only cared about football, even with me there and us having a winning record for 4 years, football was the mainstay. And me saying going to Alabama, I'm like, man, you got Derrick Thomas, Cornelius Bennett, you know, all these guys. Alabama's football is God. I want to go there. I want to go to Georgia Tech, you know, where ACC school, where all they care about is basketball. But my mom was like, nope, you're going to Alabama. It's going to be better for you. You're going to stay in state. You're going to do this. You're going to do that. And so I guess mom knows best, right? I ended up going to Alabama and had a great time and enjoyed playing there.
You there with Latrell Sprewell? Like,
yes, my junior year. Yeah.
Yeah. So you get a chance to play with a young Latrell Sprewell on that. You had like the success at Alabama. Like, what was that year that you was like, man, this is like, I'm enjoying playing with this team, this coach, this environment. We winning games. What year was that when you felt that was going on?
It was my sophomore year. You got my sophomore year. You had Keith Askins, you know, from Miami Heat. David Benoit, Utah Jazz. Marcus Webb, who played with the Celtics. James Robinson, who played, you know, with Clippers. I don't know if you guys played with
Hollywood. I remember Hollywood.
We my sophomore year, you know, we were good. And we lost in the Sweet 16 to Loyola Marymount the year Hank Gathers died. And I remember the thing that I remember most about that game is we held the game 22-23 at halftime. And then went at halftime, so let y'all go. And we start going up and down. And I remember the first time I ever stepped up as a player into a coach's face was like, end of the game, we were down one and we had the ball out of bounds on their end of the court. It was like 5-6 seconds ago. He said, all right, Robert, you take the ball. I said, no, I'm not taking the ball out. I want the last shot. Throw the ball to me. And so he was like, all right, well, you take it. And then Melvin Cheatham threw it down the court. And I missed the shot at the buzzer to beat them. And I wanted to beat them so bad because, you know, you always want to measure yourself by other players. If we'd have won that game, the next game was Larry Johnson, UNLV running Rebels. Because I wanted to play them so bad because, even though they might have beat us, and I'm not saying they would have, but everybody in the country said they would have, but I wanted to match up with them because if you look at our team, we had Keith Askins, Dave Benoit, a guy named Melvin Cheatham, myself, Mark as well. We matched up so perfectly with those guys. You know, Stacey Ogden and I were the same type of player. You know, and Jarvis Ackle was like Benoit. Well, Benoit could have been guarding Grandmama, but you wanted that. You wanted that challenge. You know, as a player, you want that challenge to see where you stand and see what you need to work on. So, but we lost. And then the funny thing about that is, when we got home, I saw where they had lost by 40. I'm like, oh, I'm glad that wasn't us.
It killed the next team.
About y'all training program that everybody you name got crazy bounce, though? Or is it that's just what they recruiting? Like, everybody, Jason Caffey came up out of there bouncy. It's like y'all got crazy athletes. Everybody come up out of there banging that thing.
Hey, if you'd have came and did my workouts in college, you'd have been like, man, y'all crazy. We had a guy by the name of Rocky Coburn was our strength and conditioning coach. And think about Alabama Heat. Think about no trees on the tar, running on the track, jumping boxes. If you look at the front of everybody's legs that went to Alabama, you see scars from jumping boxes, working on our leaping ability. And the thing that we did a lot was, like, I don't think anybody else did, we did step-ups more than anybody with weight, step-up, man. some of the step ups we would do, like what teams would do with just regular squats. And he was like, no, we're doing this, we're doing that. And it kind of started because of me, because I didn't want to do squats. I said, I'm not doing squats. And I said, I'd rather do step ups. And then my vertical went from like 40 to 46. And it was like, oh crap, everybody doing step ups because it helped Rob. The next thing you know, everybody was jumping high, running fast, and it was a good program. We had a lot of success because guys wanted it. You know, they wanted to go out there and train hard. And I think that had a lot to do with Derek McKee, because Derek McKee kind of set the precedence when everybody came. You know, they kind of like, they saw what he did to get to the league, and he would come back every summer and work out with us. So everybody said, oh, we're going to do what D does, because we want to be like Derek McKee because he made it to the league. Yeah. And we just trained hard. We worked hard. And that's what a lot of people need. You need that guidance. You need someone to show you that bar.
Be that standard. Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So your senior year, you coming out. You know, you don't got no more years of college. You coming out. the process of the draft, did you have to work out for a lot of teams?
What? Man, I went to 8 teams. Because I remember coming out of college, everybody's like, what is it? Is it? Because I started out as a small forward, then I played power forward, then I played center. You know, it was like, what is it? We don't know what it is, you know? And yeah. So I remember I had to go to Miami. I had to go to Denver. I had to go to Indiana. I had to go to Houston. It got to a point where my agent had called me and he says, oh, you need to go to New York. And I was like, I went to the airport and I got to the airport. And it was a last minute thing. I looked at the lady and it just hit me. I says, just say the flight book. Tell my agent the flight book. She's like, what? She's like, please, I was done, man, because I had been, oh, I forgot I had came to the Lakers. I came to the Clippers.
It was back to back to back to back.
Yes. And I was all over. And it wore me out. And I was, and the crazy part about it is I just knew that Indiana was going to draft me, because when I went to go work out for Indiana, we were shooting threes. I had like 63 threes in a row. I was shooting that thing, right? Boom, boom, boom. And so I was like, okay, this is where I'm going, because the team I wanted to go to was Houston. And of course, that was the worst workout I had, because that was like the 15 in 4 days. And I was dead tired. I wasn't feeling good. Because you know how you get on those planes back then? So you can get on a plane sick because it is. So I was so tired, and I was so – that's why if you ever go back and look at the draft, I'm over in the corner talking to Doug Christie. I had just came back from the bathroom because I just knew I wasn't getting drafted by Houston. I was, yeah. If I'd have been like 2 seconds late, they'd be like, where's Robert?
Right.
Yeah. I wanted to go to Houston too. I had a bad workout for them. I wanted to go to them. I was beat up. My knees was like sore and stuff. I wanted to go to Houston, but they had a later pick, so I didn't get a chance to mess with them.
Oh, yeah, you don't want – yeah.
You Houston like me though, Rob. You like me. I went all over the place. He ain't had to go crazy flying like we. You know, he was one of them top five elite guys. He go to dinners and stuff. Like, we was not only flying around from team to team. Mm-hmm. We was literally working out. They trying to have us run suicides and work out against people and do everything. So we was definitely getting tired.
Man, I remember doing all that. The Denver workout was the worst workout. They had the medicine ball where they wanted you to dunk the medicine ball. I think it was like a 20-pound, a 10-pound, I don't remember what it was. And they was like, well, Clarence Weatherspoon did it 20 times. He has the record. I said, I could give a damn about Clarence Weatherspoon, you know?
You see me right now, right? You see the difference. Yeah. Like, I don't care what Clarence did. I ain't about to do what he did either.
Yeah. They compare him to Park.
It was like, yeah, and the altitude. And then I think the one workout I really enjoyed the most was when I came to Los Angeles. And the Lakers was like, oh, we work against this. And I was like, hold on, we want you to play one-on-one with someone. And I was like, he walks out Magic Johnson. I'm like, you know, growing up a huge Magic Johnson fan. And I'm playing Magic one-on-one. I remember my whole thing was, you know, when you this is where you also learn, like, I was so hyped that it messed my game up. I was like this. this is your idol. You play,
you did something.
It was funny. You were too amped to play. And I remember one time he did a little move, and I just wanted to I'm going to block his shot. And I tried to swing at it and swat it so hard that I'm like, damn, I almost put my shoulder out of place because I tried to swat. And the whole time, I think he probably jumped an inch off the ground. He just was just, just smart, man. And that's what you got to learn. It's not just a physical game. It's a mental game. You know, you take someone's aggression and use it against them. And that's one of the things I'm trying to tell my son, because he's an aggressive type defender, right? I'm like, dude, calm down. You don't always pick your points and then, you know, go in for a steal or use his body when he thinks you relaxed to knock them off balance. And so that's the learning process. And that's what I learned from Magic Johnson.
Did Magic trash talk you, though? How many young fellas did he hit you with?
Oh, man, the whole time. I
smiling telling, you know, at you, laughing.
Whoa, young fella. You know, young,
yeah.
Hey, I didn't caught that fade at UCLA before when I was first coming in. He called all the fouls. You can't get no fouls on him.
Nothing. I was. He could have knocked me down. I was just so excited to play against him that I didn't even care. I was just, you know. But he was like just schooling you, man. And he sat down and gave me a little conversation. Said, "You got the athletic ability, but you got to learn the game. You know, it's you can have all the skill sets, but you got to learn it. Man, you have to learn. You just can't just play the game."
So you get to Houston and. When you get in Houston, like, this is star power and everybody can hoop. Like, you got the Dream, you got Mad Max, you got hitters everywhere.
Jet.
Like, how is that to play with, like, just, you know how it is as a player, you come up in high school or you come up in college and everybody is not on the level as you. So you want people to be on the level as you. Now you on the team where everybody know how to play this game. How does that feel to be on the team with somebody as good as Dream and, like,
man, you know, Dream was what another guy that I idolized growing up. I even wore the tonics in high school. You know,
by Sam Pajama.
Remember the tonics.
By Sam Pajama.
I remember those joints. I remember them.
I remember we had this place called the Hot Box. I mean, it had no AC. All it had was a fan on top of the building. And you just see the guys and just working on this sweat and I'm sitting there the first couple of days watching because you know how it is. You don't have a contract yet. You're just going to sit and watch and make sure you don't get hurt because you're trying to get that paper. And I'm just watching like, damn, I got to get stronger. These guys are, man, hitting each other and look like two big Rams, you know, running. You know, it was Dream going up against Moses. And, you know, God rest his soul. It was like, I was like, wow, this is what the NBA is about. You know, Vernon talking trash, pushing people and then Kenny, you know, him doing his little finesse thing, shooting threes, talking trash to everybody. So he could, it was a learning process. And I was so excited to get out there. And especially, you know, guys like young guy, Alabama drafted, you know, lottery pick. Who is this guy? Never heard of him before. You know, the last guy we had was Buck Johnson from Alabama. He wasn't what we wanted. You know, they always compare. If you went to a certain school and the guy they compare to say, we're not the same people. I don't even know Buck. You know, we both went to Alabama, but I don't even know him. And so it was a learning process. And it took Dream, you know, 2 years before he trusted me. I should say a year. I don't think it was just me, but just anybody because he was so good that he didn't need anybody, man.
Give me the rock.
Yeah. And it was a learning process like everything is. And I learned out of all those guys, I really appreciate Otis Thorpe because he's the one that took me to the side. He taught me about eating right. Exactly. Eating
right. That thing.
Being professional, being on time, and just understanding the business side of basketball because that's a whole nother aspect of it. You know, you got the physical, you got the mental, and then you got the business side.
Man, Otis Thorpe was chopper than a motherfucker. He's palming that bitch there.
Tell me what that was like when you got a chance to see, like, on a day-to-day basis, like, okay, like you said, you sitting on the side. Tell me when you got out there and you started being in the practices and going through camp and you started to see, like, really legit how good Hakeem was and you started to realize, like, yo, this dude is like, how was that to just witness that? Like, because I played with the best. I mean, I played with some great guys, D-Wade, Steve Nash, and Dwight was a dominant big when I played. But, like, to play with somebody that's top 50 ever, like Hakeem, how was that to see on a daily?
It was always coming up with something new. He wasn't one of these vocal guys. He was one of these guys that kind of just, you know, led by example. He was always, you know, challenging. He was like, come on, you run with me. You got to beat me. I'm like, dude, we're the same height. Why do I have to beat you down the floor? It's because he wanted you to push him and he wanted to push you. And he was just always professional, coming in, you know, sitting down and talking to guys. And I remember my favorite conversation I ever had with him was we were at a Christmas party. You know how you have to do those team dinners?
Yeah, team parties, yeah.
And he comes to me and was like, yo, Rook, I want to talk to you. And I'm like, oh no, this is like December. I'm like, okay, there's no outside. I look like, man, it's cold outside. So come on, let's go outside, let's talk. So we're outside talking. He was asking me, you know, how am I enjoying the league? Am I getting used to Houston? I'm like, yeah. I said, I'm good now. He says, so I have to ask you a personal question. I'm like, oh crap, what is this gonna be? He says, do you care if we win or lose? I'm like, Dream, I care more about when you will ever know. He says, I says, why are you asking me that? He says, because you don't show that much emotion. And I looked at him and says, you don't show that much emotion either, so what's your point? He was like, good point, but you never get excited. I said, man, I have to control my emotions, because growing up as a kid, I would get so emotional if I lost that I would get angry and hit
ready
stuff.
Ready to fight.
Yeah. Yeah, my mom was always like, you know, you're not going to win every game, but you can learn from your losses. You can always stay mentally prepared. You can always stay mentally focused and don't get upset. Learn from it. And I was telling her, I learned from watching film that it's an 82-game season, so I'm not going to get too high for every game. You know, I know it's a grind. I said, the fire is there. You just don't see it, you know. So he was like, right. Okay, I got you. And I remember it was funny because if you go back and look at a game, and I started laughing because I made an and one in a crucial moment. And I'm like, yeah. And he comes up and he says, I thought you didn't show any emotion. I said, this is playoff stream. Yeah. You're going to see a lot of emotions.
That's dope.
Back in the Rocket days when I used to watch that team, like you were so intriguing to me because you was fast enough to play the two. You can dribble good enough to play the point guard. You was tough enough to play power forward. You know what I'm saying? Your versatility, I feel like, with everything that everybody else did, was key to y'all winning them championships, to y'all being as good as y'all were. One of my favorite people on y'all team, and you had him as a rookie, is Sam Cassell. Like,
I love Sam.
Like, he's one of my favorite players, one of my favorite
people. Two-point geezers.
Like, how was it to get the rookie Sam Cassell?
It was funny because, man, Sam lived across the street from me. We went to practice together. We sat on a bus together. You know, Sam and I was just, you know, we were just there because it was weird because Sam came in and he's like, Rob, tell me about Dream. How was it playing? I said, dude, if you got, first off, talk to Dream and let him know you know the game. If you know the game, then he's going to respect you. He's going to see, okay, he's not just a basketball player. He can think the game. His IQ is good. And you have to do that with every player because you have these guys that when it comes down to the game, you know, is your IQ there where I can trust you to read a situation, understand a situation? Because when we played in Houston, it was about, you know, reading defenses, cutting and slashing. I said, Sam, just watch and learn. You know, don't get too high. And then next thing you know, Sam was taking over like he was a 20-year vet, you know, and he was doing things like that to get Dream involved. And I know he and I used to play one-on-one all the time in practice, Sam and I. And the thing about Sam was he would try to post me up. I'm like, dude, I know you got confidence, but really? Come on, man. You know? Hold on, I'm working on something. Hold on, I got to do this. I got to work on my pace. You know, I can score on you. I can score on anybody. And so he just was just, you know, that's the thing about Sam, his confidence. He had more confidence in his game. And that's what you really need in NBA, you know, outside of talent and everything, is confidence. Because if you believe in yourself, you can achieve it. And that's the thing that I had to learn. He learned it quicker than I did. It took me getting traded to Detroit and the trade falling through before I really had confidence, you know, 100% confidence in myself.
With the Rockets, like you stood out so much to me because you did everything. You was like the Pippen, you know what I'm saying? Like how Pippen was to Jordan. It was like you was the key to, it wouldn't have worked if you didn't have that versatility that you had out there. You was the only player to have it. Cause like I say, Mad Max, he's shooting threes, or Sam coming off screens, or Green on that block, but you did everything. You know what I'm saying? That's why I appreciate your game so much to that.
Thank you. I laugh at people because they always talk about, well, you know, he was lucky doing this. I says, you know what? I did what the teams needed me to do. You know, in Houston, even though and one thing about me as a basketball player, I was like, I always hate dribbling the basketball because it took too much energy. Because if you look at the teams, we always had this thing called Wolf where they had me going over here trapping. I'm all over the court trapping, and I got to run back to my man. And it was like, I used to get so mad in the locker room. My guy have 20 points, and everybody else guys to be under the average. I'm like, oh, y'all just don't care about my man.
Why the small forward got to be always be the man that double? Small forward always the man that double.
That's what y'all lanky, 6'9", 6'10", fast.
Why you ain't see the shoe guard
y'all
or somebody?
Y'all free safeties, y'all go all over the place and y'all do y'all thing. And then you better get back to your
at the top of the press and everything.
Help me. Help me. Now I look like you look at the box score like, oh, Rob, your man killed you. I'm like, yeah, but look at your man. I'm the one that trapped him and got the steals and all this kind of stuff to help you out. But nobody would help me out. But you know, it was a challenge. And you know, as a basketball player, you love a challenge. You trap and be able to get back to your guy. And for you, when you're tall and lanky, you always a double team guy. You know, you got the double team, so they can't pass out of you.
You're coming with you stopping the pass.
Yeah, and if your foreman helps you out, you say, okay, you got to rotate over here to, you know, Grandmama, Charles Barkley, all these guys that are strong, and you got to hold your own so you can get back to your guys. So it was a challenge.
I hate the boxing out, the three guys aren't the same, though.
Yeah,
it's different now. Hey, but speaking on that trade to Detroit, right? Like, that's part of the game that, you know, that we don't get to tell our side of it. You know, people, fans sometimes think, they in the NBA, they making money, it's all good, no problem. Like, but you had to, you were literally in a situation where you got traded to a team, and then only because the other player that was being traded for couldn't pass a physical, you now got to return your team. Just tell me, like, tell everybody, what was that experience like? Because I've been traded, but I've never had to go back in the trade, not go through, and then I got to go back and look at these people in the face knowing they try to ship me off.
I think that kind of messed me up as far as getting to know upper management, because I was really good friends with the coach because I was his first draft pick. Rudy T, I got to know the management. I got to know these because, you know, back then it was a smaller unit. I think they only had like 13 or 14 people in upper management. You know, now it's like an army of people. So you got to know everybody. When you get traded, it's almost like a stab in the back or stab in the heart, however you want to say it. And for me to go someplace like Detroit, you know, where they were at the bottom of the barrel, you know, they were still, you know, they still had the old school Isaiah and Joe Dumars. It wasn't going nowhere. And I knew it too, so we had the potential to do stuff because we had just went to the Western Conference Finals, you know. So I'm there and I'm like, oh, I don't want to be here. I don't want to be in the cold weather. I'm a Southern boy. I don't want to be in the cold.
Ooh, that Detroit then, Rock City cold.
Yeah.
Too.
Yeah. And when the trade fell through and Sean didn't pass his physical, I didn't care about that because all I cared was getting back to Houston, getting back to my family, and getting back to being a basketball player, because I was the type of player that I was so intent on trying to make Vernon better, Kenny better, Otis better, Dream better, that I wasn't looking out for myself. And, you know, at the end of the day, that's why they traded me, because my reluctance to shoot the ball. I was so reluctant to shoot the ball because I was just trying to get everybody else involved. And when I came back, them joints, you know, after two games, Rudy had to pull me to the side and say, yo, man, stop shooting so much. I was like, all right, y'all ain't gonna trade me again for not shooting. Y'all gonna trade this time to shoot too much.
That's the problem I saw.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So it was a learning process. I learned, and it made me understand it's a business. Number one, it is a business regard, and there's no loyalty in sports. And I don't care what anybody would ever say. There's no loyalty in sports. You have to watch out for yourself. You know, I should say there's some people that are loyal. You know, the Lakers were loyal to Kobe Bryant. You know. There's a lot of teams that are loyal to
It's a case-by-case situation.
Yeah, exactly, because I always look at, if you're going to let Derek Jeter walk out of the New York Yankees position, that lets you know this is the one, the franchise, the face of this franchise, and they was about to let him walk. So it lets you know you have to be careful. And I'm not saying every organization is like that, but a lot of them are. So you have to be mindful of your teammates and yourself and know what's best for you. So that kind of stopped me from, like, getting to know manager, because this way, if I got traded again, but, oh, well, you know, I'm just going on and doing my thing and trying to, you know, make the next team better.
Nah, that's a great, great perspective, because, like, I look at how when I got traded from Phoenix, right, we went 62-20 that year. Then after the season, I'm thinking we about to go to the summer and get ready, and it was like, boom. Blindside. All of us, me, Sean, Mari, Joe, none of us knew what was going on. I got traded. I'm like, and I'm hot. I'm not going to hold you. I'm not going to front or nothing. I had them built a crazy $7 million crib. It's just about to be completed in, like, within the month. They did that. They pulled the carpet from under me. I'm floored. Like, what? And then, so now, when everything is going through, I'm traded to New York. So now they getting my medical work. I hadn't had surgery on my back. No, I hadn't had actually I hadn't had surgery yet, but I had a I had some type of insurance clause because I had a herniated disc like the year before, and then when I signed with Phoenix, they had like a whole insurance policy and all of this different stuff that they didn't that New York didn't know about. So when everything went right before everything went through, they seen this thing. Now I'm in Chicago. I had to fly to New York, to Phoenix, take MRIs and do stuff on both. I could have foiled the whole thing, like how you said it didn't the medical. Uh-huh. I could have just if like, my agent told you like, look, you don't have to do nothing. He was like, you could sit down and say whatever, and you could have to take makeup, take back. But I'm scrappy dude. I'm hot. Like nah. I'm not going back somewhere they want me. They traded me. I'm about to do, and yeah. I'm mad. I had to fly coast to coast, bro. Phoenix to New York, long, stupid, dumb flights. Then go back home. But I was dead upset that I did it. But that speaks to like what you said. And we had a great team, and none of us, you know, everybody was upset about it. It was just what they thought they needed to do. They, you know, the chatter was we can't win it small. They went and got traded me for Kurt Thomas. I'm sorry. And you know, I was just like, well, I was hot. I ain't gonna lie to you. That just made me think about that.
You know, it's. I think people think because you're making so much money that you don't have feelings. You have feelings for the city. You have feelings for your teammates. And it's like, and when you have kids, you forget. Now you got to uproot your family and move to another place because, you know, basketball season, it starts like right before, you know, right after school. So you got to get your kids in school. You got to do all this stuff. So people don't understand. It's a sacrifice that you make jumping from city to city. You don't want to do that because you don't want to uproot your kids. You already, like, same thing with you. I was building a home in Houston, too. Right when I got traded from Houston to Phoenix. So
I think that hurt me more so than the trailer. I think it took me a longer time to get over the actual house. Bruh, I'm going to leave it alone before I get my feelings on here again.
No, don't get caught up in your feelings. I think people don't understand. That lets you know a lot of guys, they care. You know, they care about where they are. They care about, you know. And then you have to say, okay, am I being traded because the team don't want me or this other team really wants me? Yep. And so I've always said to myself, if I get traded, it's not because they don't want me, that the other team really wants me. I told myself that. So I wouldn't be like, it ain't because they want me. Somebody else really wants me. They want me more. So what they giving up, you know? So
That was what my agent kept telling me because he knew how good I was. That was his battle cry to me. Like, listen.
Hey, we can tell ourselves that loud we want, huh?
So you in this super trade, like this was finna be a super team when they trade you for Barkley, to bring Barkley over here with Olajuwon and Drexler to see if they can make another push at a championship. How was that like getting traded away from a potential team that's finna be a championship contender and go to Phoenix?
Yeah, for me, we had you know, went to the Western Conference Final, won a championship, and then lost because we didn't really have a good team. You know, we didn't have the parts. I feel like if they'd have just added, I go back and look at that team because they lost in the Western Conference Final to Utah, and I said if they would have added all those pieces and left Sam and I on that team and not Barkley, we could have went back to the finals because Sam and I brought something different to that team. And then they got some guys, you know, they got old really quick.
Yeah.
And sometimes you need a little youth to spark you. And I said, okay, I was happy they lost because I didn't want them to win a championship without luck. And then going to Phoenix, where there was a lot of animosity between the Rockets and the Phoenix from the playoffs.
Kids from Marvin Early.
and people don't understand. Everybody thinks about the kiss, but there's a long story that leads up to that kiss. And that was the playoffs that, you know, Danny Ainge hit Mario in the face with the ball. And people don't understand. Mm-hmm. Danny Ainge was a pitcher. And you can't tell me that Charles Barkley standing 5 feet away that he didn't do that on purpose. And then when I got to Phoenix, the first thing out of his mouth was, I hit Mario on purpose with the ball. And I'm like, Mario's my boy, man. I'm already not liking you. Now you tell me this. That just adds to it. And so, you know, and people don't understand that. You develop relationships with people and you're going to tell me this. I don't have a relationship with you yet. Now you're going to tell me you did my boy like this on purpose? And it's weird. If you go back you know, that happened, and we won. They beat us two games. Then we won game three in their place.
Yeah.
And he hits Mario in the face with the ball. If you go back and look at game four of that series, and you if you sat there and watched, you can see that we're not even trying to win that game. We're just trying to lay Danny Ainge out. Every move we get, we're like hitting him every move he got. Pick. You should see some of the screens. And it was weird, man, because I mean, I went up for a shot and he went up and I slammed into the floor like this. He jumps up and everybody swarmed around him. His teammates kind of backed out like, no, dude, you started this. We ain't getting that. Yeah. And that was one of the things that kind of led up to when I got the feelings for me not wanting to be there. And it's and I could sit here and talk about so many things about, you know, getting to Phoenix that kind of set me off, you know. Yeah. And I look back now and I should have never handled it that way. But yeah. To me, it got me
we
to a place.
We all do things like that. Yeah. We got yeah. those times got in me, our yeah. careers and lives. We all yeah. did it.
We only human.
Yeah, you know? So, yeah, exactly. But, you know, when you have that animosity towards someone. And Cotton Fitzgerald was a coach when I got to Phoenix, and he was great. You know, he was trying to run the triangle. And where me and Danny Ainge really got into a situation, I remember we were playing the Bulls, and we trying to run the triangle and playing the Bulls in Chicago. We got beat by 50, right? And so we in practice the next day, and we were like, well, we didn't do this in the triangle. I did the Dennis Rodman. I kind of raised my hand. And like, yeah, but I says, you know, I'm not trying to say anything, but we always talking about our offense. What about our defense? We got beat by 50. And this is where Danny Ainge lost me. He stood up and was like, defense? You're the worst defensive player on the team. And I got up and did this. Wait one MF minute. Let me tell you something. Wesley Persons is on this team. I love this guy to death. Wayne Tisdale is on this team. Danny Manning is on this team. And you're going to call me out and say I'm the worst defender on this team? I said, dude, I'm a 100-100 guy. 100 blocks, 100 steals. Don't you ever say I'm the best defender on this team, right? And I go at him like that, and then 2 days later, Cotton quits. He was in, and you know, Danny takes over, and it was downhill from there. You know, Danny's first game taking over was our game back in Houston. And, of course, you want to love. You want the fans to give you a little love, and I had been starting. So my first game back to Houston, I don't start. So there's more animosity building up. You know, I think I played like 5 minutes that game. You know, I wanted to feel that love back in Houston because every player does. You know, I want two championships there. I want to feel that love. He put Sam in. Sam got his love. I want my love, right? And after that game, I was just on fire. And I'm on fire. Then he traded away Sam, my boy. He traded away Michael Finley, my boy. He traded away Mark Bryant, my boy. So it just – it was bad.
Last of the Mohicans, man. You last of the Mohicans.
Yeah. You know, when your boys gone, they kind of contain you. So
yeah, they kind of talk to you.
So tell me your side of what happened that day in that game. Because Rex admitted it to Rex's credit. He was like, man, it's so long. He was like, I don't know. He was like, he said, let Robert tell it how it was. Yeah.
So it was we were playing in Boston. We had just traded away those guys. And Danny comes to me and says, hey, I traded away those guys to give you more minutes. I'm like, okay, cool. You know, even though I didn't want, you know, trade away Michael, AC, and these guys. So I'm out there, we playing. You know, I just hit a three. I got a steal. I got a block. I'm rolling, right? Feeling pretty good. First 3 minutes of game, and I hear the buzzer, but I don't even look back because I know it ain't for me. Then Danny Manning comes and is like, oh, I'm coming to get you. I'm like, what? I said, I'm rolling. No, I'm coming to get you. And then I'm on my way back, and I walk by Danny, and I said, man, that's effed up, man. He made me say, go sit your ass down. And I got down to the end of the bench, and I'm like, did he say what? And then I walked back and sat next to him. I said, what did you just say to me? He said, I said, go sit your ass, man. And you da-da-da-da. Some things I don't want to say. And I said, F you, and threw the towel in his face and walked back to the end of the bench. And so, and if it weren't for Paul Silas, you know, I love Paul Silas. I don't know if you ever played for him, but Paul Silas is a great guy. So we get back in the locker room, and he's sitting next to me. Like, calm down, fella, calm down. And then, Joe, I can't remember Joe's last, the big-headed Joe, I just call him that. He got, we don't do that kind of shit around here. I said, first of all, you pee mother, I'll go off, right? I said, you ain't got, I said, You all soft. That's why we used to beat your ass when I was in Houston. You're all soft. You don't want to practice. You know, you're going around here thinking the game is easy. I was like, help y'all. And then Daniel's like, what? I said, man, come on over there. Paul said, calm down. You know, in Boston, that locker room, they had another room. And other room, so Paul took me in the other room. And because I remember it was me, Chucky Brown, and Mark Bryant. I think the three of us was going to fight that whole team. You know, because they were taking Danny Ainge's side, which they should have because that's coach. And they all had been there and played with Danny a long time. We three had no relation. We three hated Danny Ainge from the series of playing with him. So they took me to the side, you know, and I calmed down. You know, they said, then I got a call from Colangelo, said, we're going to suspend you for 2 games. I'm like, that's fine with me. I said, and then I was so happy because the rumor was they was going to release me. I'm like, yeah, I'm just going to go back to Houston, right? You know, because, you know, you get released. I can go back to Houston.
Yeah, she was saying, yeah.
But thank God, Sandra Sabalas went on a little sabbatical to Lake Havasu, and the Lakers like, oh, we can't have you doing this, and they made that trade. You know, and Danny Ainge was like, and people don't understand. You have emotions, and if you go back and you see the emotions that started from point A to point B, there was a lot of fire and lava that was starting to blow for this volcano erupt, and he was just like pushing my buttons one by one by one. And then at the end, when he took over as coach, he thought he could, you know, he still talked to me that way because he was the head coach, and I lost, you know. And so it put me in a great position to play for the Lakers, but you know, at the end of the day, I wish I would have handled it differently. But
yeah,
3 championships later with the Lakers, who really cares, right?
Straight up. I'll trade that any day.
Before we move to the Lakers, I got to ask because, you know, this is something that I hear a lot of banter about. The 2 titles you won back-to-back in Houston, right?
Yes. Uh-huh.
I just recently heard Kenny saying that he thinks they still would have happened if MJ would not have retired.
Yes.
I don't agree with him. Do you? You part of that team. Do you feel? Mm-hmm. I feel like I know what you're gonna say, but you feel like if MJ don't walk away, if MJ don't walk away in '93, y'all still gonna win them 2 championships.
We're gonna win those 2 championships because we had Dream, and people. I want you to look back. Everybody says, okay, the Bulls went out and revamped that team. They got Kukoc, they got Rodman, they got Jason Kaff. I mean, they got all these guys to make them better because they just got beat by Orlando. They were, you know, everybody's gonna say, well, MJ wasn't in shape. He already played 40 games. He was in shape. He just dropped 55 points against the Knicks. He was in shape. You know, he just got beat by faster, younger team. And if you go back and you look at a team, you know, would MJ have gotten past the Knicks first? People don't respect that Knicks team. That team, oh my goodness, Mason, you know, Oakley, they were a beast. And don't mm-hmm. they don't think John Starks were no punk. He would win at MJ like an MJ would win at him. And so I don't know, would he have gotten out the East? People always want to talk about us. Would he have gotten past the Knicks first? If he'd have got to us, he wouldn't have got past us because this is what I tell people. I played for Phil. I know how Phil coaches. I know he thinks the triangle is the best offense ever. We ran the triangle in Houston and just didn't know it. We just didn't call the triangle. We call it 15, get the ball to Dream and get out of the way. And so if you look back at the matchups, at those teams, and you go back to the regular season, even go back to the regular season, we beat them in the regular season on a consistent basis. So for them to sit there and say the Bulls would have won, no. And who – What franchise outside of the Boston Celtics, and they only play like, 40 games a year, would have played 82 games a year and won 8 championships in a row? Negative. You know, your body gets tired.
This the only thing, me being born and bred from the crib, I would be remiss if I didn't say this. I'm just, the way I felt and the way many of us Chicagoans felt, if Michael was lacing them up from the time where he broke down the door in 1 and 91, if we had the year that you're talking about where we lost to the Magic, as soon as Mike announced he was coming back to play the Pacers, the whole city said, we the champs again. That's how entitled, that's how much we knew. Because, and I'm telling you, I feel what you're saying. You saying they didn't have this, they didn't say that. But I'm telling you, I know I speak for many Chicagoans like me. If we had Mike and Scotty, nothing else mattered. we was going to figure it out. No matter, I mean, because the truth of the matter is, them 6-1s we won, that was what it was. As long as we had Mike and Scotty, it was going to happen. For a full season, like, I feel you, we didn't have him for the full, and, you know, that could be argued about whatever, whether he was tired or whatever, I don't know. But I'm just saying, Chicagoans, once he won in 91, we knew it was over. Hey, oh, Mike Scott, we champs again. That's why we, even in 98, when everybody talking that crap, we still, to this day, it's Jerry Reinsdorf and Jerry Krause and them fault. We could have got another one, and however many of us, if Mike wanted to come back, until Mike said he was walking away, you can't tell none of us that he wasn't going to win until you walked out. We would have had to see it. It's one of the things you got to see it to believe. You know,
and I guarantee you, a couple of years back, when Miami got LeBron, Dwayne Wade, and Chris Bosh, you'd have said they're going to win like 4 in a row.
Yeah.
You'd have said that, right?
Yeah.
All right. So, and you would have told me with Karl Malone, Gary Payton, Shaq, and Kobe, they'd have beat Detroit.
Yeah.
So there you go. You can't say because you got the best out there that the best product is going to be on the floor, because who knows? You get a hot streak. Look at game 4, Clyde and Dream both have 40 against Utah. You never know. You got people don't understand Vernon. Everybody talks about Clyde. Everybody's like,
oh, we Clyde saw what Clyde going to do against MJ in the finals.
And that's, you saw that when he was with Portland. You saw
okay,
when he was
where
with Portland.
Was that? It's Michael. And it's Clyde.
I'm not saying they're on the same level, by far. I'm not saying on the same level.
Like this.
But what I'm saying is, because you got to understand, Clyde was the best player on that Portland team, so there's a lot of pressure on him. Now he comes to Houston. He ain't got no pressure on him. All the pressure falls on that big Nigerian down there that nobody can stop. That
until he play that Black Cat in the finals, then he got all the pressure because you mano a mano, hey, and that Nigerian can't
Dream,
help.
Dream feels no pressure, man. He feels no pressure.
I ain't talking about Dream ain't got that pressure. I'm talking about Clyde when he is like Hakeem and Mike ain't matching up.
Hey, but I'm saying though, let me ask you this question: who was gonna guard Dream?
That's gonna be a problem. Nobody. I don't care what millennium or what I'm talking about. I don't care what era you're talking about.
My whole point is the caliber of guy that's got the guard Dream is nowhere near the caliber of the person that's going to guard Mike. You see what I'm saying? Because, you know, you're trying to say Clyde is not a top 50 guy. You forget that. He's a top 50 guy.
I didn't say he wasn't a top 50. I was just saying Mike. And
you don't even have a top 500 that's going to be guarding Dream. So,
but what I'm saying, when you look at those, the honesty to me is like, that don't matter. It didn't matter if it was top 5 or not. Dream gonna do it. Just like it don't matter if it's top 50 or not. Mike gonna do it. That's what I'm saying. They'll watch. It don't matter. Like, ain't nobody about to check Dream in no millennium. He was the man. I ain't trying to. Don't get those words, Vickers.
So basically what we're saying is it's gonna Mike and Dream is gonna be a wash. So it's gonna be up to us, the rest of us, to try to figure it out. You know, so
they gonna cancel each other out. 240 balls.
But we still would've won it though.
Straight up.
Hey, I can't expect you to say nothing else. Kenny would be all on your head talk about that.
Hey, I'd be mad at myself for me to sit up and say we wouldn't want it. Because, you know, the thing we did in 95, nobody would ever be able to do the things we did in 95, you know?
Straight up. Well, you get to the Lakers, you got young Kobe coming, you got Shaq. And these guys haven't won, but you got guys like you and like AC Green, you know, guys who actually won in this league, trying to get see the talent in these young guys, but trying to get them on the championship low. How was that when you first got to the Lakers, and how the environment was before Phil got there?
You know, it was crazy. You know, when you say the Wild Wild West, you think of this team. You know, we had All-Star Nick Van Exel, All-Star Eddie Jones, All-Star Kobe Bryant, All-Star Shaq. We had a lot of talent. But we just weren't able to put it together on the court. You know, it was so many different things that affect us. You know, we had Eldon Campbell. We had all these guys, Rick Fox. And we just had no camaraderie on the court. It was just like it was too many good players, and we didn't have any specialists. You know, we need someone to come out and say, okay, I'm going to do this, you're going to do this, and you're going to do this. And when you got 4 scores, you know, it's going to take away from someone getting hot. And you know, you got teams, like you see teams now where, like, look at the Pistons, who have 4 great players, 4 all-stars, and they was able to do it. But they didn't have to worry about Ben Wallace shooting. You didn't have to – Chauncey ran the show, and he shot when he got ready, but he got made sure Rip and Rasheed
Yeah, you have to worry about she wanting to rock all the time.
Exactly. Yeah.
They were a special group too, though. Their chemistry and everything was different.
When you have four all-stars like that, but these were four specialists. You know, Nick could get some assists, but most of the time, Nick had to go up against a lot of good guards, and Nick was trying to prove his own. He said, I'm trying to make my mark. Eddie Jones trying to make his mark. And of course, that young Kobe Bryant, he was trying to make his mark. So it really wasn't a lot of continuity going on the court. So you had to make some changes. And some guys had to, you know, step back and look at themselves and say, hey, you know, this is a spot for me. I got to do this if we want to be successful. And that's, I think if every guy in the league took step back sometimes and said, what do I need to do to make this team be successful? There'd be a lot more successful teams and, you know, a lot more guys, you know, willing to, you know, lay down their body and make the team better.
When Phil got there in 2000, that's when we got drafted. Yeah. Like, when we got drafted and we played against y'all, it was like, we played against everybody, but when we played against y'all, it was like, they can't be beat. Because, like, even if we fight enough and have a good game and get the game close, Kobe will end this bitch for him and we can't beat him. Like, in 2000, when Phil got there and just the different type of confidence that Shaq and Kobe had within themselves, what was that season like to start that three-peat off?
You know, when you have someone who's coached the GOAT, you have someone that brings respect. I think Shaq was scared of Phil and respected him so much that he finally got in shape. Shaq was in great shape going into that season. And so, you know, that's why he won MVP. And everybody was like, okay, he coached Michael Jordan. He coached Michael Jordan. If he can coach Michael Jordan and Michael Jordan respects him, we got to come out and play up to a certain standard. And it was, and I think due to the fact that they enjoyed them so much and respect the field so much, they enjoyed playing for him. And that was a big deal with all of that, because if you have a coach that's respected by the players, you're going to go out and lay your heart on the line, just like, you know, with Pop, everybody respects him, so they're going to come out and play hard for him. But he brought a certain quote-unquote zenfulness to the team. Guys got on board. And everybody talks about, Shaq and Kobe, but the key to that team was Ron Harper. You know, Ron Harper came to that team, and he brought a certain maturity. He brought a certain, you know, veteran leadership to that team that we needed. You know, he came and he knew the system because he had won championships on the field. And he got everybody in the right position, and everybody were like, you know, when Phil would get upset, Hart would do this and tell us what to do to bring him back into the fold and tell us what. So Hart doesn't get talked about, but he was a big, big key to our success, not just on the court, but off the court. And he brought us together. He got us to play on the field, and it was a great moment for us to play on the field, because it got Kobe to understand that Michael Jordan need teammates, so you need teammates. It got Shaq understanding to get in shape and be a dominant force and dunk on everybody. And got everybody else to get in line, because nobody wanted to get traded and leave LA because it's a great place to play. So everybody else kind of fell in line.
Like with that team, like, let's talk about your role in that team. Like, you always hit the best three, like the three to put them up three, or like, you don't score, you don't do none of this. Like, you always in the game, and you always hitting the shot when they get it right. Like, to be on a team like that, to accept your role, to do the little small things that people just don't see on those stat sheet.
You know, for me, I remember being back in Houston where I got plays called for me. You know, I was going from every year I was in Houston, my points went up, right? And I was, you know, As a young guy, you say, okay, this is what I need. Then you get to Houston, you realize, okay, I don't get no plays ran for me. I can either let this bother me, but then you sit back and you look at the situation and you analyze it. You know, at the beginning of the year, every team know if they got a chance to win a championship or not. You know if you got the talent, and you see around the league and what they have. And I looked around the league, I'm like, man, ain't nobody as good as us. Man, we got some talent. Yeah. We can win this thing. We got the right pieces, because I've been on championship teams, and you need certain pieces to be successful. And so as a player, you said, okay, well, you're going to accept this role and do what's needed for this team. You know, my favorite line to say is, I don't make the product. I make the product better. I says, I go on the team, I figure out what's needed.
Like
from going to, you know, when Shaq goes to free throws, going up to talk to him, to making him relax and, you know, say, oh, man, he's free though, man. Yeah, you missed this, we lose, big deal. You know, trying to get his mind off it. You know, going over to people like, you know, Kobe and just saying, hey, Kobe, you know, let someone else shoot the ball. You know what I mean? Yeah. So it's just things like that, because when you win championships, it brings respect. And I think Phil bought respect, and I bought respect, and AC bought respect. So those guys kind of listened to us, and along with Harp, and they were like, okay, you know, these guys know what they're talking about. They've been to the mountaintop. So for me, it was a process. And it was a process for me. It was a process for them. And good thing that we learned that process quick enough to, you know, go to the finals.
When I play you on the game or something, like, I'm starting Robert Horry. I'm not starting A.C. Green or Horace Grant or Samaki Walker. And it's like, did you ever trip off, like, dang, why y'all putting them in front of me and I play the key minutes or so forth on? Did you ever have a problem with that?
You know, I didn't, to be honest with you. I never did, because for me, when I had to watch guys from the bench, guys have tendencies. Guys are going to be like, okay, this is what I'm doing tonight. You know, if you watch most guys, you know a guy's his routine. You know what he's doing. If he's hot, he's not, how to stop him. Because we all have a game plan zone. You know the greatness, and we know their weaknesses. So I would sit back and watch and like, okay, he's doing this tonight because he thinks this is working for him. So and AC would beat him up, and then I would come in to finesse. Everybody, you know, it was like the two guys, everybody hit me was always beat him up, and I would come in for the finesse part. But it was a process, and I didn't care because I was playing fourth quarter. Who they counting on? Me. And that's all that mattered to me. If I'm in there at the fourth quarter, and plus I looked at me for that I could be fresh by the end of the game so I could play. Now I had to play all these minutes, you know?
Yeah.
It's a marathon, you know?
So I see how you do it, because I used to be crossing Devin George them up. As soon as you get in the game, you sitting on my crossover. I just see your hand right there. I'm like, oh, he's sitting on my crossover there. I'm out here crossing Devin George them ass up, running up and down court. You get in the game, I'm sitting on that.
You have to be observant when you sit on the bench. You have to learn. You watch the best players. You watch the guys you might have to guard, because you know you got your favorite move. I don't know your favorite move. I'm not a good defender. I need to know your favorite move. And so, and then your backup moved to that. So, you know, I know when you get in transition to try to get in front of you to slow you down, because, you know, you and Q, when y'all used to get in that transition, boy, it was like, get out the way. You can't slow them down. Just get out the way, let them dunk. Do the knucklehead and get on back.
Let me ask you this question on that. Like, what did you think of us as young kids? Because we were the youngest team. We had, like, high school kids. What did you think of us when we got to L.A. and we was playing for the Clippers, trying to make some noise in the city?
To be honest, hated you guys, because you guys started the era of no fear. You know, you had no fear because you wanted to make your mark. You wanted to come out there. You were fast. You were high jump. You was that new hybrid. You could do everything. Wasn't anything you could do. So I remember, and it was like, we got to beat the Clippers. They're like cross-town rivals. These young bucks are going to come here with this energy because they're trying to make a name for themselves. I'm like, oh, my goodness. I'm like, so I'm like coming off the bench like Shaq, Kobe, get up early so I don't have to play. So, I don't want to have to go out there and chase these little young guys all over the court. And it's weird because when you come across guys like you guys and then you get the dunks and you start doing your stuff, I'm like, I hate these motherfuckers. But you respect it because that's one thing I always admire about people. You don't fear anybody. You make them fear you. You try to make them fear you. You go at them, and that's what you guys used to do. You was like, y'all didn't fear anybody. Y'all went at someone and said, I'm going to make my name. I'm going to go at you just like you're going to go at me. And I always had an appreciation. But in the back, I said, I hate these dudes. Because, you know, you're young, you're fast, you talk a lot of trash, and it was just, you know. And it's cute. You know, you talked a lot of trash on the side. Nobody ever said that about you, but you talked a lot of trash, man. I'm honored that y'all put me on the show, even though I was sitting back like, I didn't ask me to be on the show yet.
Oh, no, we, trust me, we want you, OG. It was no question. We want you. We looking for you. This is a good question, because I argue with folks about this question all the time, and you actually played with both of these guys. Like, I love Dream. Dream is one of my favorite players ever, but I just feel like the prime Shaq, the 2000 to 2003 Shaq, I don't see a center can withhold four quarters of that shit.
That's who, like, I'm picking every time.
So, like, Dream, no, and that Lakers Shaq. Like, I know Dream got in his ass. in the 90s, but like that Lakers Shaq was like, I never seen a player like that ever in my life that dominate. And I don't feel like a center, no matter how good you is, won't take four quarters of that shit.
Man, you know, that was the year. It was a special year. I know you guys know it because the Staples Center was just being built.
Rocking.
Phil Jackson was a new coach. You know, we had, you know, Kobe and Shaq had just came off getting, you know, we had just shut down the Forum. The Spurs had beat us. And so those guys were, you know, they were like, okay, what's going to happen? Phil's coming in. So Shaq had his shape. You know, if you look at some of the pictures of Shaq, he even ripped a little bit. He got some little rips in his arm.
Yeah, like, nah, that was, yeah.
And that's the first time I said, now that diesel tattoo represents you very well because you diesel up in this joint. So, you know, he was just in shape. He was just, you know, getting up and down the court, dunking on people. And I wish that 2000-2001 Shaq had the same mental, the same health for I'm not going to say in 95 because he might have beat us in that championship game. But from there on, the years I played him, because that Shaq was crazy because he had the footwork. In his case, he said the feet work. He had the footwork. Mm-hmm. He could do anything on the post. You know, he was dunking. He was making free throws every now and then. But, yeah. You know, he was so dominant in the post. I remember Sabonis. Think about this. Sabonis was the strongest and biggest guy in the NBA. And he was just moving him like he was nothing. You know, I guarantee you if Shaq, in 2004 Shaq would have been the 2001 Shaq, they would have probably won that chance. Ben Wallace would have been able to handle him. You know, to watch Ben Wallace play that Shaq then, who wasn't in shape, well, I should say he was in shape, but not the top shape he was back then. I was like, who is this Shaq? You know, who is this guy? But he was, when he was in shape, man, he was like no other. He was a force, man. He
Thanos.
He would dunk on people. He got handles, man. And he just was a guy that was putting the league on notice.
Yeah. We had the opportunity to do an interview with Kobe back in September.
I saw that. Yeah.
And just his energy, the person he was becoming, and just him, that aura. You had a chance to be with Kobe when he was like young, and to see him right before he passed, the father, the husband, the man he become. Like, just speak up and just touch on that if that's cool with you.
Man, yeah. It, you know, for me, I had just saw him 2 weeks before that happened, and we were talking about, you know, basketball, talking about it. And I looked at him and said, dude, I can't believe you coaching. And I can't believe you coaching over there with no emotion. He said, I know, right? Yeah. So, you know, it's just weird to see, you know, when you talk about maturity, this guy matured. He had so many different layers. I mean, when he was a rookie, he was like so energetic, trying to learn, trying to beat everybody, trying to, you know, go one-on-one with everybody. Then him learning that he needed his teammates, and then, you know, understanding that, you know, you can pass on some knowledge. And I think every player out there would love to have their older version come back and tap them on the shoulder and tutor them, because I would have loved to play with the Kobe Bryant at his later years. You know, when we played with Kobe, he was good to me, but he still had that wall up where he didn't really let people in. And I think that had a lot to do with the age gap, because when he first got to the Lakers, you know, guys were mad at him because they took the beer out the locker room because he was, you know, 18. And people would get that at the end of the day.
I didn't notice that.
We used to have beer in the locker room because that's what guys used to do. They took it out because of him. And I think, you know, we would go out after games. You can't go with this young fella. It kind of separated us. You know, he can only talk on, you know, the bus for so long in practice. And I just wish that I would took the opportunity, to talk to him more. I mean, one of the moments we had the most fun with he and I was we were going, I forget where we were flying to, but we sat together on the plane and we got to talking. He was talking about, you know, how much, you know, videotape he watched, you know, he was asking me how was it play with Dream, how was it play with Vernon. And he was unbelievable person, man. I think if he wouldn't have played basketball, he'd been successful in anything he wanted to be, because the kid was. I want to know if he ever took an IQ test, because I think he was a borderline genius, man. Because the things he's done in his life, the things he able to accomplish, either he has a twin and he don't sleep, Oh, he got to be the smartest, one of the smartest people you ever come across, because just to sit down and talk to him and to get to know him was a blessing. And, you know, and you hate that someone who was building a great rep for ladies basketball, for his family, you know, had to go out that way, man. I think I was one of those people when my wife's nephew called us and said it happened. Oh, man, stop playing. And I think I even went on the show to do the show at Spectrum, and I still was like, it ain't real, man. This ain't real. And because it was just such a devastating event to happen. And, you know, I lost my daughter when she was 17. Now, this woman has lost her daughter and her husband. I know she is devastated. And you know, and people always talk about Vanessa, but, you know, they always talk about Jellybean and his wife. They lost their son, you know, and it's such a tragic moment for you to lose in a way like that. You know, it's just, and it goes back to what we said earlier. Yeah, I always think about this. What if he didn't have the means to have a helicopter? You know, what if he didn't have this? You know, we do things because we have the means, and sometimes that can put us in harm's way. And I just wish he would have drove there that day, man. You know, if he drove there, it was foggy drive. You know, we still have him with us to, you know, pass on the knowledge, because I would have loved to have a last dance with Kobe Bryant. You know, and I know they say it's a room that's something out there, but I want to see him be in the spot that Michael Jordan's in. Yes,
yeah, his own word.
Yeah, exactly. So it's you know, I keep saying again, it's just tragic to lose someone with so much potential. I know it's weird to say the word potential, because he had so much potential after basketball.
Yeah, so much.
You think back and you start crying about it, man, because you don't realize how important people you come across are to you in your life. You know, it might be just for a moment, you know, especially when you get the chance to win championships with them and share all those, you know, moments on the court with them. And that's that brotherhood of basketball that our fans would never understand.
So how was that when y'all went experiencing that, the first, and then going through that three-peat with that team, like watching Kobe become Kobe, and, you know, Shaq have MVPs, and both of them just become the one of the best duos we've ever seen?
You know, it was a process, and you know, everybody always talks about the rivalry those two had, but they never showed it or presented it in practice, in games, on the bus, in the locker room. It was always respectful of the guys in the locker room. So, you know, for them guys to come together and play off one another and do the things they were able to do was incredible, because, you know, you got a young Kobe who was just trying to make his mark. He was trying to be the GOAT. You got Shaq who's trying to get a championship and make his reign as the best center in the game. So you got these two guys both trying to establish themselves, but they learn how to work together. They put aside, you know, their own personal goals and put the team first. You know, Shaq got his MVP, and we were able to dominate. And it was a rotating, you know, power forward. And that's why every year I was like this: am I going to get traded? Am I going to be here? But it was always the AC. Then we got Horace. Then we got Samaki. You know, the power forward door was always, you know, a swinging door. But we was always had that mainstay in Shaq and Kobe, and those guys were able to, you know, coexist and do things on the court to make us successful. And it was always weird to me when people ask me about the relationship between those two and what happened. I'm like, man, we never saw it. It was always something that popped up in the media, and they were like, what?
For real?
They would come to practice and ask us, like, well, Kobe said this about Shaq. Shaq did. They're like, what? One day we got so tired of it. One day they came and I said, you know what? Let's trade them both. Let's be done with all this, right? and Shaq comes to me. He's like, man, you trade me? You know, you say so. It's amazing how the power of the press. I say something like that, and they wrote it in the press. I'm like, dude, I was only joking when I said it, but they made it me like, man, we should just trade both of them. I'm like, I was joking. Who wants to trade Shaq and Kobe? And I told Shaq, where are you going to trade with? I said, Utah, so you can play with Greg Ostertag. So, you know, we had that kind of relationship. But it was – those guys were so great to play with. You know, I've been very fortunate to play with, you know, some great guys, some awesome guys. But, to watch Kobe grow into a young, you know, wiry kid trying to learn the game, trying to make his mark, to the mature guy who can take over a game and also – you know, draw a defense and get the guys the ball that he know in the right position to score. He was just, you know, awesome guy to play with. And Shaq, you know, being so dominant, passing out of, you know, I played with some guys that are selfish. But those two guys, they had a right to be selfish, but they weren't selfish. You know, people like to talk about Kobe being selfish. I'm like, he was selfish to people who couldn't play. People he didn't trust. But, hey, he wasn't selfish to me because he got me to rock plenty of times.
So. Swinging that motherfucker every time.
Exactly. So, it's you know, we all been in that situation as a player. When we come down, we look to the corner, and you got JoJo over there who can't play. You're like, oh, I'm going to take this because I believe in me more than I believe in JoJo.
He ain't going to hit that shot.
Exactly. So, you know, those guys understood who they played with. And they brought the best in each other, and they brought the best in their teammates.
I couldn't believe the Lakers traded you, like, let you go. Like, how did that go down? And man, it's a blessing because you get to them San Antonio Spurs, a blue-collar team that want to win.
And for me, it was very hurtful because I knew the moment Phil got there. When you hear, you know, when you hear your names and rumbling and rumors all the time, you always like, okay. And every year it was like, we need a new power forward. We just won a championship. Oh, we need a new power forward. We just won a championship. Oh, we need, you know, right. So on. And then once we lost to San Antonio, it was like, oh, because Tim Duncan, I remember, I'm not even going to lie, I feel like David Robinson when he was guarding Dream that year. He was pulling out stuff that I hadn't seen before. He learned my little tricks, and he started facing me up where I couldn't, like, hold him down when I would go to block a shot. You know, little tricks you learn in post. And we lost, and after we lost to San Antonio, I was like, I'm out of here. I knew I was out of here because they wanted Karl Malone so bad. And you know you out of there when you go to the final meeting. You know, you have the exit meetings. You know, like the year I had the option to opt out, I walk in the exit meeting, they all stand up, hey, Ronald, hey, good season. And then the year there was their option, I walk in the exit meeting, have a seat over there. You know, it's a big deal. As soon as I walked in that exit meeting, nobody got up and greeted me. I said, oh, I'm out of here. You know, and it was just one of those things that I'm like, okay, Karl Malone or me? Hell, I would take Karl Malone before me, you know. But the thing about it is, would I take Karl Malone to fit in with this group? No. Because now Karl Malone gets in the way of Kobe. He gets in the way of Shaq. And me, I draw the defense out of me. Hey, I tell everybody, I said, I'm the best decoy you ever going to have on the court because nobody's going to leave me at the end of the game. You know, so Karl Malone, they might leave and say, okay, you can't shoot it from that range. So I knew, and it was hurtful because when they let me go, it was like right when all the money had dried up. And so they had the option. So I was like, I was really floundering in the wind. I didn't know where I was going to go. And then somebody that San Antonio, I don't know who it was going to give that veteran exception to dropped out. So they said, hey, you want it? I said, yes, I'll take it. This is what also people don't understand. I signed a 1-year deal with the Spurs, had an awful year because when you play for the Spurs and that system they had back then, if you try to play basketball, they're going to look at you like you're crazy because they were so robotic. And you know from playing them that they were robotic. They would do A, methodical. B, C, D, methodical. And it was methodical. But I wasn't that type of player. If I see a back door, I'm cutting back door. And the whole team would stop and look like, what are you doing? And so I remember the next year, we got Michael Finley. I told Michael Finley, I said, dude, you got to dumb your game down. He like, what? I said, not in a bad way, but when they say go ABC, go ABC because you mess up the system. And I had to learn that the hard way. So my second year, I took way less money in my second year with Spurs because I had such a bad year and I felt that I didn't have a Robert Horry type of year. That I said, you know what? I owe you a year. And we won it in 2005. And I said, then this is a Robert Horry year. And then they gave me a 3-year deal after that. So
how was it like transitioning from Phil to Pop?
It was about the same. You know, Phil wouldn't really talk to you but Pop would come and talk to you, take you to dinner, buy you a glass of wine. You know, he loves his Italian, buy you some Nokia and all that kind of stuff. Phil would just come and, like, you know, talk to you, basketball, all right, read my book, you know, that I gave to you for a Christmas present. How's the family? Good. And then he would move on. Pop would, like, really try to get to know you. I remember when my daughter got sick and we were doing training camp. I left and went home, and then I came back. He was like, what are you doing here? I was like, is she out of the hospital? I'm like, no, get out of here. Get out. I don't want to see your face until she's home and she's 100. And I'm like, what? I'm like, but I'm fine. No. I said, he sent me back home. And I don't think there's a coach out there that would do that. You know, I know they're bought out now because of the social media and the aspect that things are out there and people are going to play, you know, the sympathy card and want people to like them. But he did that before social media, before anybody knew the things he would do. And it was just a special feeling, you know. But the common thing that they have is they both love to win. They both want you to play defense. And they both want you to run a system. And nobody is more important from the first guy down to the 12th guy. You might have a different role, but your role is no more important than the guy over here that's pushing you in practice every day, you know, like a Mark Madsen or somebody like that.
Yeah. One of the guys that you played with for the Spurs, I got a chance to play with against him when I came out in the USA international game. And I feel like he's very underrated too, is Tony Parker. Like, how was it to play with Tony Parker and see how good that he got the floater king?
You know, Tony is probably one of the quickest guys I've ever played with. He was so fast. And if you watch Tony, like his three, my first couple of years there wasn't good. He couldn't shoot the three. He didn't have a mid-range, but boy, for him to be, 6'2", and lead the league in points in the paint. And people don't understand that he led the league in points in the paint, and he gained his body up. He would get in the paint and shoot that floater, man. I'm like, dude. And it wasn't like the floater day where everybody holds their knee up and it's all pretty. Nah. It was just really quick, and it was in there. And he was –
pirouette, all type of stuff in that lane off that pick.
Yeah. The thing that I will say about Tony, though, he worked hard every day on his shot. I mean, he would be in practice 2 hours before practice start, after practice working on his shot, because he knew that was his weakness. And you have to respect him. But he was cool guy, so amazing to play with. You know, he wasn't the best passer, but he was okay passing. If he would have been a good passer, you probably could say he could be up there with, like, Jason Kidd and Steve Nash. But his passing skills was the only thing that probably kept him from being one of the elite point guards in his league.
How was y'all looking when Manu showed up and he turned out to be as good as he was? Because I can't remember what draft he was in, but he was like a second-round pick and basically was not supposed to be really anything. Stayed overseas for a couple years. I remember us kind of knowing about him because we played with his teammate from overseas, Marco Yarick, and him played together in Italy with Rashard Griffith, actually from Chicago. They had been winning like championships overseas in the EuroLeague. And so when he came to us, he was telling us like Manu is really good, whatever. But we didn't, you know, nobody knew or really didn't know what was going on. What did you guys think when you got to get a load of him?
You know, it's funny. You know, we American basketball players can get kind of, you know, boisterous at times and don't think anybody can play outside of us, right? And so I remember when we was with the Lakers and Manu was a rookie. I'm like, he's a 30-year-old rookie. I'm like, you know, who is this dude? You know, and so I remember my last game as a Laker, Manu killed us. You know, he was going at Kobe. He wasn't afraid of Kobe. He was left-handed. You know, left-handed guys are hard to stop. You know, he was getting to the hole, shooting those floaters, you know, doing a Euro step, trying to dunk on people because he had incredible hops. And he was just a beast. And I'm like, hey, this Manu Ginobili kid is pretty good. And then when I got to the Spurs and got to watch him every day, I'm like, he has no fear. It's not a shot he don't think he can make. You know, he can get to the hole. His IQ is extraordinary. And you really don't get an appreciation for guys until you see them every day. You can sit back from afar and admire them, but when you see them up close and you can see it for 82 games and a plus, you're like, man, this guy can go. And that's why I said that about Manu. I was like, he had no fear. I remember one game he went to the hole and got kneed in the thigh and had a bruise like this on his thigh, big knot, you know. Yeah, and for him, he just said, no, wrap it. I mean, I got to go. He coming out of the court limping on one leg and still played. And he had that heart of a champion, and he played, and Manu was, you know, like you said, underrated.
I'm not going to lie to you. I despise guarding him. I despised it. I'm telling you, for all of everything you just said, because okay, he's fast, but he's shifty. He's shifty, and he got that Euro, I'm gonna make my head flop if you tap me, and I'm the physical dude, so I'm like, all right, I'm gonna have to put some of this strength on him. Like, as soon as you tap him, he he drawing fouls, I'm yelling at the ref, I'm frustrated, like, every time. But, like, listen, my year in Phoenix – if it was no San Antonio Spurs, we the champs. They was out, y'all was our Achilles heel, but I'm talking about, oh, I hate it. It was like, bro, one time Pop didn't play none of them. He said Timmy, Manu, and Tony, and I think, I can't remember it. I want to say either we lost or we barely won, and he was playing a mental game with us. He just didn't even bring them, like, y'all don't play tonight.
Didn't play. Yeah. I remember because I got booed like crazy that game. But it's funny because Manu is the first person outside of Sham God to do the Sham God in a game. That I was like, oh, he actually did that at work. You know,
remember.
People don't understand. Manu had some crazy. They wasn't handles like that, but they was crazy shifty handles. He'd throw it and come this way. I'm like, oh, I'm like, Manu could play, man. He had no fear in his hops, man. He would dunk on you in a second. He would quick dunk you left hand really, really fast.
speaking of that game, you checked Steve Nash. You didn't try to check him that hard. You just tried to stop the break. He just went that hard. Because I was like, man, it don't even seem like he tried to check him. It was just like, dude, that hard, but he went so hard.
Thank you. Thank you. You know, here's the thing about people says, well, you push them. I said, dude, when you push somebody, you do this. I went over and did this. You know, Steve Nash was my rook. If I wanted to hurt Steve, he'd have been on the other side because I could have did that. You know, I was going, my whole intention was going to that play was get ready to try to take that charge. And I didn't get over in time enough. I said, oh, well, they're going to call a foul on me anyway. So I'm just going to brace. You're going to brace. You're going to take that, you know, because I'm from the 90s. That's how we play. You gonna, and this is the playoff. You gonna feel this foul.
It was a whole lot of Snash did a whole lot of Denzeling on that side. Like,
yeah.
He all out.
I even slowed it down. I said, watch how he look back for the thing and he goes, oh. I'm like, really?
Hey, first of all, Stevie is one of the toughest dudes on the planet. Know Stevie, he was like, I'm about to put a little milk on this so we can maybe get him thrown out, see if we can get it happening.
Yeah, and the funny part is everybody says, when you checked him and you broke his nose. And I said, dude, first of all, when he cut his nose that time, that was in Phoenix, and he bumped heads with Tony Parker. And he was tough. He was like trying to play in half the skin of his nose on the other side of his face.
I've seen him kind of twist his nose back on
Steve
TV.
Steve Nash is one of the toughest dudes I've ever played with, period.
Yeah, Steve and I had a lot of fun. You know, Steve and I was rookies together in Phoenix. I mean, he was my rookie in Phoenix, and we used to play one on one at lower gym in Phoenix before games. We'd come to the game and be dog tired because we knew we weren't going in the game because we knew we was gonna sit on the bench and just chill his rookie year. I'm like, I mean, one game they put us in the game. We looked at each other like, what? Huh? And so we went out there. And we practiced pick and roll, but we doing the lower gym without nobody. And everybody like, that's not the play, but this is our play. Get out of the way.
Right.
You have big shots from the 90s to 2000s, like big shots. I'm talking about Western Conference Finals against Supersonics, like against the Rockets, against Sacramento. Out of all them big shots you had, which one the ones that stick out the most to you that was like them ones for you?
Big shot, Bob's favorite big shot.
What's you know, your favorite big shot?
I think for me, the first one is not number one, but the first one was, like you said, against when I was with the Rockets when we were playing Seattle in the game 7, and I hit a jumper from the corner to send us an OT. You know, that shot doesn't get talked about. For me, on a personal note, you know, it's a confidence booster, and it had to go along with that, me believing in myself, you know, getting traded and doing all these kind of stuff. But then at the end, you have to believe in yourself because nobody else will, and it gave me confidence. And then, you know, for me, then go from that, we were playing San Antonio in the Western Conference Finals, and I'm like 0 for 6 in the game. I'm 0 for right. And, you know, Dennis Rodman was leaving me because I wasn't knocking any shots down. End of the game. Yeah. You got to focus. And, you know, for me to pump fake the ball to Sam in the corner, Sam was like, man, I wanted to be the big star of this game. And then taking a dribble in and knocking down that shot to win that game against San Antonio. All confidence boosters to get to my favorite of all time was, you know, Game 4 against the Western Conference Championship against the Sacramento Kings. You know, growing up a Laker fan, to do that in front of your fans, you know, because all those other shots were done on the road. You know, to do it in front of your fans. And for me, you know, walking the Staples Center, they didn't chant my name that often. It was all right. Kobe, Shaq, you know, and then not be able to knock down that three in a pivotal game, you know, that game, you know, we lose that game, we go down 3-1. We don't know what happened, right? Tie that game up 2-2. And to have those fans chant my name. And that's the only shot that I can see on a replay that gives me goosebumps just watching.
Right, right.
And it's not the actual shot. It's the camera shot from overhead. And when all the fans jump up, and you know Carlos the ball boy, right? And Carlos streaks across the floor.
Run see, that across
it gives
the
me
floor.
it gives me goosebumps because to be down that many points and to do that at home in a playoff game, you know, that's the number one
can't
shot.
Can't be described.
You saying that, that's one of my favorite things about that moment and about that celebration. The ball boys were celebrating like they play on the team.
Yeah.
They in the middle jumping up, yelling. Yeah. Like that was a live moment. So
funny story about that shot though. We were losing, and Mark Masson was like, "Wow, we're gonna lose this game." I said, "Dude, I got this. We all right. We're gonna win this game. I got this." And after I shot it and turned around, all I could see was Mark saying, "You said we were gonna win. You said we were gonna win." So you know, and that's just the part, you know, trying to get the confidence in the young fella, you know. So if he got in the game, which he knew he wasn't, he would have some confidence that we're still gonna win. And then
Mark Masson, one of the best guys I ever met.
Too funny.
Exactly. Yeah.
Mark is one of the good dude.
And it's funny that you go back to my other top five is, you know, the shot when, against Detroit when Rasheed leads me.
I just saw that the other day.
On the road again. You know what I mean? It's on the road again. For me, I love beating people on the road. And I don't have many pictures in my home, but that's one of the pictures that I have in my home of that shot because I love watching the facial expressions of everybody in the picture. You got the people, you know, you got all these shots and it's just weird. And to do that in a situation like that where we needed game five, we went up 3-2 in that series and on the road. And you know from playing that team, Detroit, they want no pump. Rasheed.
And their fans were not about it either.
Yes, Rasheed, one of the most underrated players to play this game because you know, they always look at his text. But that dude could play. And for him to leave me like that.
Big time.
Yeah.
Defense and offense.
Yes. That shot was great because that whole fourth quarter for me was amazing, man. For me to, you know, have 0 points at halftime, talk to myself during halftime, Bruce Bowen look at me like I'm crazy, and then go out there and just light him up like that. And to light him up with no plays called for me. You know, all those shots I took were shots I just said, F it. You know, I'm going to shoot it because the Pop, you call no plays. And I always want to go to Pop and actually, dude, you know I was hot. Why are you running in place? He never ran in place. And you look at every shot I took, it was shots. I literally broke the offense and just took the shot because I was feeling that good.
Straight up. Everybody was confident in it. Definitely was. When you shoot, when you build your rep up like that, like, man, that's why I feel like your career is so unique. It's so much for the history. They can't say nothing about this NBA without saying Robert Horry's career and what you done did and the shots that you done make, man. It's definitely a blessing to get a chance to witness some of the stuff you done. One of the things I want to talk about that they don't talk about enough, OG, is how you used to dunk on motherfuckers all the time. I remember you used to dunk on motherfuckers all the time.
Yeah.
Like, tell me some of your favorite dunk on, some of your favorite bodies you done caught when you done dunked on a couple of people.
I think one of my favorites is, because I just saw it the other day, was game 7 in the finals. I dunked on Patrick for the first 2 points of game 7. And I didn't notice it until my son Christian was like, "Dad, you kind of knocked him over." I dunked on him, Pat kind of stumbled. I was like, "Oh, I did." And then also in that series, Byrne threw me an alley-oop from out of bounds. And it was when I set plays where I fake like I'm coming off Dream and come back from the alley-oop out of bounds. And I dunked that on Oakley. And I just like, in Oakley, I realized, like, this Oakley dude, I better not be yelling in his face. You know, that was one. But another one was we were playing the Portland Trailblazers. And, God, I can't think of the guy's name. Clifford Robinson went for the steal. And I got it.
Cliffy.
And then I took a bounce to the goal. And I can't think of the guy that Shaq hit. I can't think of that.
Sabonis?
He jumped.
Brad Miller.
No, the other guy, he played with the Knicks too, had a white guy, blonde, big nose.
Dudley.
Yeah, I think of it. Yeah. So I took a bounce, I turned, and dunked on him backwards and sat on him.
I remember that one.
And one of my other favorites is I remember Devin George loved this dunk. We were in Minnesota. I drove baseline and kind of shot it, and I saw that I was going to miss it. And so I followed it, and I got my own tip dunk on like my friend Sean Rooks, who's, you know, God rest his soul. So I got that tip dunk on him. So it was, yeah. So it was. I had a lot of good dunks, man.
Oh no, you got a lot of good ones. People don't know that. They don't remember you.
Not as many as you though.
You got bodies. You got bodies.
Oh my goodness, I can't forget this. This is one of my favorites too. I forgot about this. You know, as you get older, your kids get to watch you play basketball, right? My son Cameron was like, "Dad, you never dunk anymore." And I said, "What?" I said, "I dunk." He says, "I've never seen it." So we play in the Pistons in the finals in that game five. You know, I'm hot. So I take that dribble and I go and I do the dunk where I dunk on rip, right? I barely get there. So I'm kind of as a dunk because I dunk on rip. And after the game, I'm like, you know, my dad and Cameron was there. And I'm like, you know, I was like, "Cameron, did you see Daddy's dunk?" He's like, "What dunk?" I'm like, the really good dunk I just got. He's like, "No." I looked at my dad. He says, "We were in the bathroom." So, so one of my favorite dunks is my son missing. It was funny because, you know, I have a guy named Opie. Opie, he does these paintings. And I have a painting for each championship. And in that championship, in each painting, he does these things called ghosting. He has the ghosting of the shot I made against Sacramento. He has that dunk that he ghosted in one of my paintings. So, you know, I think for me, that's like one of my top two dunks of all time because I was able to do it in the finals and at an old age. You know, it's special when you get past 35, you can still dunk.
Yeah, straight up. Tell me how you got started with your AAU program. How did Robert Horry, Big Shot Bob, get started into coaching in the youth?
Blame my current wife. Our son was playing on this team, right? And I would watch the team, and I'm like, they just playing. They don't have any continuity. What are they doing? They're a good team, right? So I started, you know, taking a couple of guys on the team, and we would go and just work on some skills, right? And next thing you know, a couple other players would come. Like, "I didn't invite y'all." I'm like, "Oh, we told them that." And then next thing you know, the whole team is, I'm running practice with the whole team. Like, hold on. And, you know, then the parents say, "Oh, you know, why don't you just take over the team?" And I'm like, "Listen, I'm a different kind of dude. I'm gonna say some things that they might not want to hear, but they all listen to rap music now. They gonna hear worse." And so, and I just, you know, I had some great kids, man. I could tell them to run through a wall. They would run through a wall, and the thing I liked best about them, they were smart. They were smart. And then watching my son, you know, people laugh at me because my son on the team is the best player, and I'm not saying it because he's my son. He's the best player. I ran no plays for him. I said, "Dude, you got to figure it out." I said, "You got to talk to your teammates and tell them what do you see on the court." I try to make him think the game. I say, "Do you have a mismatch in the post? Well, go to the post." I said, "Do you have a mismatch? Bring it down." "Yes." I said, and so I try to do that with all the teams. I said, "Get to a position where you think is your strongest position, and, you know, we're going to figure it out to make you strong." But it's fun, man. I really enjoy coaching those guys, and I hate COVID-19 happened. Now we can't get in the gym. We can't do nothing because it's always so satisfying when you see the growth of a player and know that you had a hand in that. You know, a lot of those guys are not going to go to college, but the fact that I had this one guy on a team, his name is D, and he's never going to play high school ball, but I used to make him sit by me because the kid was smart. He was like, "Coach, they're double teaming over here, over that." And I would tell him, I said, "Dude, you might not be able to play this game, but you can coach this game. Make sure you put yourself in a position to do it," because he will literally tell me stuff as a 12-year-old. And I'm like, "Dude, some people have that. They have that smarts about it. You know, you can't play it, but you can coach it." And I want to see where their mental is. I want to see what they're thinking, because that's one of the things I love about Rudy T as a coach. When you have, you know how you have the timeouts now where the coaches will go out there and huddle, talk to other coaches, and come back and give you a game plan. Rudy T would talk to him and come to us and say, "Hey, what are you guys hearing out there? What do you want to do? What do you feel comfortable with?" And then we would tell them, and we would go from there. And that's the kind of coach, if I ever coach, that's why, because the players have a feel for what's going on in the court, you know, more so than the coaches do.
Start, bench, cut. You got a start one, you got a bench one, you got a cut one.
Oh, my goodness.
Tracy McGrady, Dominique Wilkins, Scottie Pippen?
Well, see, if I cut Tracy, everybody gonna say that he and I have a beef because people that think that will happen one time when I say you got to get your own. So I can't cut him. So I'm gonna have him come off the bench. And because Scotty thinks the Bulls would have beat us, I'm cutting his ass. And I'm starting Dominique.
Oh, he did, OG. Scotty, get up out of here.
Bulls ain't beating us. Get up out of here. You played in this league, and you didn't win the scoring titles. You won, like, top 10 scoring when you was playing. But you won the most clutch players ever to play this game. For people to recognize you as, like, you know, when you put look at that clutch category, they Kobe's, LeBron's, like they saying all these people who won scoring titles and stuff. But out of all them people, that one person that wasn't winning all the scoring titles is Robert Horry. Like, how does it feel to be mentioned with them people?
Oh man, it feels great because, you know, I love the fact that is mentioned because people who know basketball respects that about me. You know, you got these people who have this platform through social media. Now, oh, he was a bum. I said, if I'm a bum, what does that make you? Because you never made the NBA, right? So, yeah, he's like, oh, he never averaged over 9 points. So, like, I said, dude, you know, I did average over 9 points. It got to a point in my career where it kind of dwindles down. But that's beside the point. But for me, to know that, you know, my peers and people who know basketball, you know, to call me clutch and call me big shot and all this. You know, I always tell people once you get a nickname and it's a positive nickname, you know, you kind of made it. You know, you kind of did something that left your mark. And so for me, I love it because the fact that I love it is when I go to Vegas, I get the drink for free because every time I run to somebody, yo, man, you want me a lot of money. You want me a lot of money. All right, well, buy my dinner then. Buy me a drink. So it's funny that, man, but for me, I look back at my career and know that, you know, I left my mark. It might not be a MVP mark. It might not be any personal goals that I had set for myself when you first came, but I left a mark that I never thought I would leave. You know, being considered one of the most clutch players in this game, a player that nobody want to leave when his last second on the shot clock. So that lets you know I did something that opens a lot of people's eyes and that, you know, that a lot of people can't say because we know there's a bunch of people out there. We know we're not going to give them the ball down the clutch because they're going to, you know, miss it. And they don't have the balls to do it.
Yeah. There you go.
Speaking of like nicknames, like you say, to have a nickname in this league is like your golden ticket for everybody in the world to call you Big Shot. How much do you love this nickname? Do you love being called this? Like,
you know, it's weird, man, because I've always been a humble guy. But when people call me Big Shot, it's like, for first, I was kind of trying to shy away from it. But now I realize, like, I like this name. You know, even my AAU team was called Big Shot. You know, it's funny that it you know, my wife gets mad at me because she's like, you don't do this. You know, you deserve this. And, you know, I'm like, I'm not that type of person to, you know, to toot my own horn. She's like, and then I start breaking down stuff she don't know. Like, yeah, she didn't know I was the first 100 blocks, 100 steals, 103. She's like, yeah. Real? I said, yeah, I have an NBA record for steals in the final. And I start giving her all these things. She's like, see, three, that's what I'm talking about. Fourth, said, why did I even tell her that? You know, most consecutive. It's like I'm telling her. She's like, why you see this way? You need to do this.
So you added most stew in the pot, nah?
Yeah, I didn't even know it, right? So but for me, I just wanted to play the game, enjoy the game, and have a lot of fun doing it because at the end of the day, that's what it's about because that's what we start doing as kids. We play it for the fun of it, you know, because it's so much joy in it. And I never played it for the accolades. I never played it for to go to the Hall of Fame. I just played it because it was fun. It was a way to get a free education. And that was a way to have a great job that I don't really call a job.
Man, OG, man, it's been super, super real, man. We appreciate you. You done gave us way more than enough of your time. We appreciate the love, man.
This my is pleasure, just a, man. Hey, I'm a huge fan of the show and a huge fan of you guys when you played, man. I had a lot of respect for you guys. Now to see what you guys are doing on this platform and let guys get their voices out, man, I appreciate it, man.
Hey, man, y'all hear that, man? That's straight from the Big Shot, Robert. Big Shot, Bob. Or
seven rings. Y'all get.
That's what I'm talking about. Seven times.
Seven rings.
One couple more than Thanos did. You know what I'm talking about?
Seven rings.